All of the equations of these lectures are on the middle page for the class. Okay, so let's take a look at a rule of thumb that would be very convenient if you want to charge a very beneficial price for your employer. We want to find the price that will equate marginal revenue to marginal cost. But the question now is, in general, what is marginal revenue? So you remember that for any firm, marginal revenue is the price times the amount sold. So if, for example, the price is $2 and you sell 100 pizzas, then your revenues from pepperoni are $200. And there we have it. So to divide marginal revenue, we want to take the derivative of total revenue with respect to Q, which is output. All right, so we will take marginal cost as given. Instead, go ahead. I thought that somebody must have a question. If you do, feel free at any time to jump in with your question. So, we want to take the derivative of revenue with respect to the amount that we are producing, and that is Q. But this will require a little bit of calculus. So let's reintroduce the rule of derivatives that affect products, such as the product of price and quantity. So suppose that G is a function of two functions, subfunctions, f and g. Then the derivative of g with respect to x, as you recall, is derived by holding one function constant and then divide, getting the derivative for the other function. So there, the held constant f of x is like a coefficient, and then divide the derivative for g with respect to x. And now let's do the same thing for F. So there is the product rule. Okay, so far. So this is an example. Suppose that the function f is equal to 2x, and that the function g is equal to 3x, then the function g is 2x times 3x, or 6x squared in this case. But for now, just for an example, let's keep G very simple. So by the product rule, if we treat the product of f and g as a new function g, then the derivative for g, I will denote this with an apostrophe. This is the derivative for f. This is vector x times g, which we hold constant. And then do the same thing again with respect to f. Okay, so following our rule, the derivative of f with respect to f is just 2 times g, which is gx in this example. And then the same thing for the second term on the right hand side. We hold that constant for the 2x. And then take the derivative of g equal to 3. So in this case, adding up the two amounts, we have the derivative of g. Let's just say the x is 12 times x. Okay, so far. Okay, so here is a puzzle for you. Suppose that f of x is equal to 2, a constant. And then g of x, f to 4, is equal to 3x. So for one point of extra credit, what is the derivative of g in this case? of using the product rule for capitalists.
Excuse me, isn't it 6?
Sounds good. So let's see. There is a useful rule and now we look to have the derivative of f with respect to x, but f now is a constant. So what is the value of the derivative now?
0.
Exactly.
Zero.
So we can ignore that first term. And then from the second term, as you say, f is a constant, so the derivative of g, which in this case is equal to 3. Or 6 all told. Sorry. And we can double check by choosing g as one function rather than as a product equal to 6x. And then thirdly, the derivative of g is just equal to 6. So that satisfies the product rule. And now we can go back to economics. So R is revenue. There's a function of output. And we just saw that this is the product of the price as determined by the demand function. The highest price that people are willing to pay for some given amount of output. Price times sales. So now let's take the product rule and apply the revenue here to compute marginal revenue. So what do we have? Let's see. Let's divide the derivative of the price function holding two constants. And then holding the price as constant. And taking the derivative of Q with respect to Q, which is such is only 1. So there is marginal revenue, the price of plus the change in the price given output. So what is the economic intuition behind this formula? Let us see. For a monopoly, again, the monopoly is charging the highest price that it can sell at. So if it wants to sell another pizza, it will have to lower the price, not only for the new client, but for all other enthusiastic customers of anchovy pizza story, for example. So, that wants to sell another pizza, that's a monopolist to me. So, she will have to lower the price to send me the pizza, and then lower it for her usual 10 customers each week as well. Let's say to a thousand Peggy. So the amount of money that she makes by selling me the additional pizza, most importantly, includes the 1,000 penny that she receives from me, minus the amount of money that she has won, that she is losing because she has to lower her price to her useful loyal customers. So suppose that the initial price is 1,100 penny. So when she lowers her price to her useful customers, she is losing 100 penny per customer. 100 penny times 10. Well, in this case, unluckily for Bogdan, most of the revenue is zero. She makes money from me. But not from her useful customers. And that's what the formula says. Here is a price that the new customer pays, and then here is the amount of money that is lost on other customers to turn this negative. Okay. So there is the economic interpretation of the monopolist notion of revenue. Now, let's play just a bit of a trick on our revenue function to come up with something that is a lot more valuable than the subject of monopoly pricing. field service are useful muscle of deficit. Now, here's the second term of this problem. So these people become clear in just a second. People multiply through the term by the price, the value of the price. So did not change anything. P over P is just one. And then we will factor out the price for both components of marginal dividend. So in the second term, we are using price twice. We will factor out the numerator in that term and then keep the price that is in the denominator compared to the price to Q. Okay. Now notice in this second term that we can rewrite the expression as the relative change in price of relative to P. So all that we have done is to rearrange these components. And then we will put in the denominator of this expression, dq already in the denominator, and then divided by q in the numerator. But of course, this term is the inverse of the price elasticity of demand. And so in the second term, we will rewrite the inverse elasticity. This is 1 over E. Okay, so far. So we found that most of the evidence when transformed is a price. Plus this expression. But this develops a change in price and develops a change in property. And you remember that in general, the price elasticity of demand is the change in output that occurs because of the change in the price. So you remember that, for example, if the elasticity is equal to 2, then a 1% change is an increase in the price will decrease sales cube by 2%. Okay, so far. All right, then the only remaining step is to observe that in marginal revenue, in the second term, we are using the inverse of the demand elasticity. This is the inverse of this. So to make marginal revenue very simple, rather than use this complicated expression, let's just use a simple notation for the elasticity. Or over 1 over E, where we will understand that E is always never positive, it is usually negative. And there you have it. Finally, to maximize profits, the monopoly must be paid marginal revenue to marginal cost. In other words, that a pizzeria will sell a pizza and another pizza as long as the money she receives from the pizza can cover the cost of baking it. Then revenues at the margin drop to the extent that they barely cover marginal cost, but that will not sell any more pizzas. The net pizza does not lose money, so pizza does not provide it. So that is our condition for profit maximization. And then let's be divided to do some notation that will save us trouble. And now, finally, we can solve for the monopolist price, just marginal cost divided that 1 plus 1 over E, the elasticity E. And this is a very simple formula. Okay, so here's a puzzle for you. Suppose that the elasticity E is bringing to negative infinity that is this product is very sensitive to price in terms of its demand. So raising the price even by just 1% will just about wipe out demand. Maybe the elasticity is negative 1,000. So this happens now to our price. A bit the maximized profit for this firm. So 1 point above the credit. So what do you think? Let us see in an expression, E is now a very large number, a very large negative number, maybe minus 1 million. So the fraction of 1/-1,000,000 is going to 0 overall. So the denominator in this case one plus 1/E, where E is negative, is just about equal to the 1, since 1/E is basically 0. So that means that in our formula for maximizing profits, the price is equal to marginal cost, and that's it. The firm now has no pricing power because consumers are not willing to pay even a slightly higher price. So the moral of the story is that for the competitive firm, pricing power is very limited. Because they can always buy pizza, not from Bob, not from Karina instead. So Bob cannot raise the price high above the cost of providing another pizza. she cannot raise the price above marginal cost. And there is a story that we have. The monopolist takes into account the elasticity because it will determine how much room she has to raise the price. If the elasticity is very large, she will not be able to charge a very high price. The greater the elasticity in absolute value. Okay, questions so far. You do not need to worry about the derivation of the pricing rule unless you want to have extra credit on an exam. But you should be comfortable with the pricing formula itself that you're. A very useful formula that the first directly reflects marginal cost and also reflects pressure elasticity of demand. If you forget the formula, you can always cut it down from the PowerPoint slides on the middle page. Okay, to give a puzzle to you, suppose that our demand elasticity is -2, and that marginal cost of the pizza is $10. Must be an exhilarating pizza to cost that much. So this will take a couple of minutes to determine the price that will maximize profits for that pizza house. 2 minutes, and then we will get back together to solve the problem as a class.
Excuse me. The profit maximizing price is 5. I got 5.
Oh, well, let's take a look. So you think that the profit maximizing price is 5 in this case? actually, these are very close. But this pickle woke up the problem. So most of the cost is 10, in this case, $10. And then the elasticity is -2. So in a formula for the price, divide 10, by the denominator of 1 of minus 1 over e, where e is 2. So notice that because the elasticity is negative, we have taken that into account right here. 10. Divided by 1 minus 1/2, which is just 1/2. Or 10 times 2. So notice that because we have a fraction in the denominator, we invert the fraction to put it in the numerator. So the maximized profit to the dot is $20. So you are very close to the answer, just have to remember that the invert. Invert the fraction into the denominator. Okay, so that's good for a couple points of extra credit for you. And then the other question is, what is the markup of this trace with respect to the marginal cost? In other words, how high is this trace when we compare it to marginal cost? Well, marginal cost in this case is $10. The price is $20, so the markup is 100%. The price is twice as high as marginal cost. What is so far? No problem.
No questions for now. Thank you.
Okay, good. Thanks. And there is the answer. If you want to look it up, while studying at home, it's in the PowerPoint slides. Okay. So that was a hypothetical example. But let us look now at the realistic example from grocery stores. So Idana is running Government Mart, and she knows, as in fact is the case, that the price elasticity for food in general is very low, minus one. But the elasticity is very high for a particular seller of food, the Bellabart. So the first question is this: why is the demand for the supermarket so much larger than at the value than the demand for food in general? Just a bit of economics. So let's see. Idana is running Double Mart, and then perhaps Vava is running a rival supermarket, let's say Magnum. So if Idana tries to raise her prices very high, Idana will be undercut by Vava. Vava will perhaps lower her prices in order to attract customers away from Bellabart. Well, maybe that's what happened to the green bar, the green supermarket, no longer around. Prices have been too high. So here's the question now for you. What is the price markup that Golden Mart can try? In other words, how high is this price compared to marginal cost? So if it would take a couple of minutes to think about that problem, and then we will solve it as a class. Okay, so what do you think? How high is the markup that doubles our tensile? Let me see, using a formula and assuming a very general property for marginal cost, we have in the denominator of that expression 1 minus 1 over 10. So the price elasticity is minus 10. So 1 minus 0.1, of course, is just 0.9. So what is on markup? Well, we could figure it out from the Excel spreadsheet, but let's just do it on our own. So we have 9 divided by 10. That is, in the numerator, marginal cost times 10. And then divided by 9. Or to make it even simpler, marginal cost times 1.1. So that the markup is not really large. Government can raise the price over marginal cost only by 10%. Do you think that is realistic? When I go to government, I do observe that most prices are fairly low, especially for items like bread or vegetables, on which government must compete with other supermarkets. So the formula just seemed to work in this case. Or 11%. Okay, and here's one last example for designing jeans in a multi. So it turns out that the actual price elasticity is just about 2.5. And then the marginal cost is 1750. So my question for you now is, what price for cheese will maximize profits? How much higher is that price than compared to marginal cost? I think that this problem will take you about 4 minutes or so, and then we will reconvene. 4 minutes. Go ahead and try it.
Excuse me, Professor.
Yes, go ahead.
Can I say my answer or is it too early?
Go ahead, yes.
I got $31.25, which is the profit maximizing price.
About $31. Wow. Okay, so let's take a look. So our marginal cost is $17. And then in our numerator, we have 1 minus 1 divided by 2.5. So let's multiply through the 2.5 both sides. Divided by 2.5. That is 1.5 divided by 2.5. And then to make life easy for us, let's multiply both the numerator and denominator by 10. That is, in the numerator, we have 3/5. Inverting the fraction gives us 1750. That's 5/3. So the markup for designer jeans, this is a realistic example. The markup is 67%, 2/3. So yes, that looks like he was doing the $31. I think this is correct. Or just to have the men on the jeans. So that's good for another couple points of extra credit. Well, there is another way to calculate the markup. In this case, by the overall change in price relative to the initial price. So if we define markup that way, the markup is 40%. Just up to you about how to determine that. In my calculations, I did $39, close enough to 31. And then finally, I have a problem that you could solve at home. Again, a realistic problem, this time for a drug that will contain ulcers. A drug that also patients take from us to Merck. And there are the facts. Each dose costs 20 to 40 cents to produce. So that's very close to marginal cost. And then the demand is a 50 for this drug. This very low, only about -1.1, almost price inelastic. And then finally, we need to think about at home, what price should the drug company charge, and what is the markup in that case?